In the last class, we discussed about the shifting of bits, whether you want to shift it left or right, and we can use these symbols, okay, to move it right, or if you want to move it left, you can use this symbol, okay. Now, then after that, we talked about logical and arithmetic shift, okay. And especially when you are moving the bits towards right or left, you have to keep an eye on the system, whether the system is doing logical shift or arithmetic shift. Many a times after making a shift, especially in case of right shift, the system may be using its own approach, or it may be using logical shift, maybe, and you might be thinking that it is making arithmetic shift and vice versa. So you have to be very careful that the program and your ideas are both matching or not. Okay. Now today we are going to talk about arrays, and I will not be going in depth in the arrays or pointers. We have discussed about pointers before. And these are mainly important concepts in C. And these concepts are very important when we are dealing with embedded systems. Okay. If you can recall, we were in one of the lectures, I told you that the ports are actually mapped. And if you check the address bus, okay, this address bus here I am showing from A0 to A9 only, but it will go up to 32 bit. But you can see from A9 to A2, okay, A9 to A2 are mapped to the ports of GPIO ports of the microcontroller. And A1 and A0 are not mapped, okay. You can say they are here. A2 to A9 are mapped from D0 to D7, okay. So here these two bits are left 0 always, and rest of the bits we can use from A2 to A9 to make an LED on or off in the ports of the microcontroller. Here we are showing the port F. Okay. Port F of the microcontroller, because in the board TVC, we have the microcontroller and P0 and P4 are connected to switches. P1, 2, 3 are connected to LEDs. So this is how the internal structure is. And from here we can see, though we can control the ports P0 to P7, okay, the bits of port, okay, of port F, but in actually A0 and A1 are not used. And I asked the question also, why this particular bits are left 0 or not used, and I was expecting an answer for that. Until date I have not received any answer. Remember, 3FC is because if you take this bit stream up to 31 bits, okay, so 0 to 31, so total 32 bits. If you map it, so you will have the first, you will have the basic base address, okay, and then after that you will have the 3FC to control the particular pins of the port. Now I asked you a question, why this particular two bits are not used, and I especially said that in ARM architecture mostly even addresses are used, they avoid odd addresses. And what is that particular technique called? Anyone? Because this is one of the important features of ARM. We are handling Cortex M4, which is a 32-bit microcontroller. So why these two bits are left or they are not used? Anyone? Why the last two bits are not used? Anyone? Look, I always ask some questions related to the microcontroller and I expect that you put some effort from your side. It is not that I will be just taking a monologue kind of class. You have to interact, otherwise you are not going to learn anything. Anyway, so still I am leaving this question to you. Why these two bits are not used? Okay, please try to find the answers and try to find what is the technology called, okay, or the technique called. So 03FC is used to enable all 8 bits of port F. So you have the base address, and if you check, the base address was 4002500, okay, of port F, and 3FC is used to control the 8 bits of the port F. Now, in the beginning, we started writing our code using the approach of typecasting and pointers. Okay, I believe you can recall this is typecasting. Okay, this particular part of the code is using typecasting, and this particular star here is doing the job of a pointer, and we are telling the system that this is our base address. Okay, go to that address and dereference that address, and dereferencing, or we can say dereferencing the address, because this star here is dereferencing. So you can directly enter some data into the particular memory address. I believe you remember the concepts of pointer. Okay, so this was the approach in the beginning, and we found that it is very tedious task to write this kind of lines, and it is very time taking also. So the next approach that we can adopt, or we adopted, was to refer to the header file, and from the header file we can again dereference the header file, and this is the address of particular, and this address in the header is written in this fashion. So if you can check here, these are the addresses of that particular header file. Okay, so these are all different ports. Port E, the base address. Then to control that port C, you can add 3FC here. If you see here, 3FC. Okay, that will be pointing towards the data register of the port E. And then direction register, and then you have all different kind of registers, digital enable register. Okay, so we have used till now, we have used data register, direction register, digital enable register. Again, other than that, you have many other registers which can be used to use the different facilities or features available in a particular pin. For example, I told you the one pin can act as a digital read or write, and the same pin we can configure to do the job of analog reading, or even we can use the same pin for SPI communication or I2C communication. So that means one pin is multiplexed around so many different functions, and we can use different functions around one particular pin. And this was the same with the Arduino IDE also. So here we can see that in the header file, we are just basically writing this particular address and defining it using preprocessors, okay, or macros we can say. And from there, we are defining this particular name, that GPIO port F data underscore R, to represent the address at 4002 53FC. And if I want to write something in this particular address, 400253FC, I rather than writing this complicated line, okay, I can write GPIO port F data underscore R. And then I can again dereference the same thing. So putting a star, that means asterisk here, and putting this particular variable in the bracket, we can dereference that particular pointer, and then we can enter any value that we want. So again, same concept is used here. We are actually dereferencing that particular name and entering the value which we want to make the LED on or off. Okay. This is the second approach. And in this approach, we are using just basically the pointer arithmetic, because we are using the pointer only, and this is defined by using the macros. Okay. Done. Third approach is, further we can simplify this same technique. Okay. And we can use the array representation of arrays, or using the approach of arrays, we can do the same thing. Why arrays can be used here? This is the first question. How can array be used here? Because any answer why arrays can be used in this case, like for example, here we have defined it using typecasting and pointer, or dereferencing the pointer, or we use the macro to define a name and use that particular variable to dereference an address. Now the question is, how this same technique can be used for arrays? How arrays can help our programming?
Sir, we can assign an initial index value of particular address, and then we can increment according to our need for that value in an array.
Yeah, correct. So here we can use the array, because the most important feature is that you can see all the addresses are following or are basically incremental in nature. So and arrays, and if you can recall arrays, they are also variables which can keep the address of the initial index, and then following that initial index, rest of the data are actually incremental. And that's why we can use the same array approach. So this is your variable. In that you are telling the index. So here you have the index, and then you can tell that index should be of what value. So you can enter the value into that index. So let me briefly talk about the array. So for example, if suppose I declare a variable int value, so defining an array, okay, so 5, and then curly braces, so 1, 2, 3, 4, okay, so you have entered the array. Now the question is 4, okay, we can keep it like this, okay. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now the question is, if I say how this particular thing is managed in the memory, first question. So we have the memory, okay, going like this. Okay. So when you define the variable value, now the first question that comes to the mind of the system is that, what is the data type of that particular variable? So the data type is int. So int means the word size of the system will be int. So that means if the system is 16 bit, int will be representing 16 bit. Okay. If the system is 32 bit, int will be 32 bit. This is clear. Okay. But now we have a variable which actually needs 5 values inside it. Okay. Now the question is, how the the system is going to allocate memory for this particular variable. So definitely it will give all this range of memory to the variable called value. But value is not the whole memory. But now the question is, what is the size of this particular memory in that case? This is your memory. Okay. So memory that will be given to this variable value will depend on the data type. So data type into the number of indexes that or values you want to enter into that particular variable. So suppose, assume we are talking about a 16-bit system. Okay. So in that case, int will be 16-bit and the memory allocated or provided to this variable value will be 16 into 5. Okay, so that means this memory will be divided into chunks of 16-bit. Each chunk will be 16-bit. Okay, 16-bit, 16-bit and so on. Okay. Okay. Now, the first question is, this is your index 0. Then you have index 1, index, okay, this is index. Index 0, index 1, index 2, index 3, index 4, index 5. Okay, so now the question is, this particular variables or the values that has to be entered into the variable will all be represented by using 16 bits. So if you see 1, so 1 will be represented like 0, 0, 0, 0, okay, 0, 0, 0, 1. So this will be all 16 bits taking the size of first variable. So this is your index 0. Okay, next will be your index 1. Similarly, index 2 and so on. Okay, and each data will be represented using 16 bit 0, 0, 1, 0. And so on. Okay, so now the question is, that means each variable that you are entering here, when I am saying value here, that means 1, 2 or 3, which are located at index 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on, these will be having their own addresses. Okay, so memory, in the memory, you are allocating the addresses. So the first index is here, the address is here. Okay, the first index address is here. The second address index will be here. The third here and the fourth here and so on. Now the question is, how the system is going to help us? Because in array, all the data or the data that you enter into a variable of any length, okay, are all written adjacent to each other or in an incremental way. Okay. So now the question is, if I want to access any of these addresses, I can just say value 3. Value 3. Okay, and I can even write some other value like value 3 is equal to 35, assume. Okay, so in that case, what will happen? The system will take, or the pointer will point to the index 3. So index 0, 1, 2 here. Okay, index 3 in this location. And the variable now, that means before it was 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4 here. Now what will happen, this 35 will be taken to that memory location and it will change the value to 35. So in this way, we can individually change one of the values of the array also. Okay, by pointing to an index and using that index to enter a new value. So this is how the same approach that we have used previously. That means use the pointer, dereference the pointer, and write a data to a memory. Whereas here, we are taking an array. Why we are taking an array? Because all the addresses in the microcontroller are sequentially arranged one after one. Okay. And that is one of the features of an array. And definitely all the data types are also same. For example, here in the array, you can see int is the data type. So all these variables 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, they will be all represented in int or integer type only. You cannot have a system where you declare an array or a variable in an array value int, and you can assume or expect that the value at this particular location will be float. Okay. It is not allowed. So in an array, all the data type, all the variables should have the same data type. Okay. And this feature we can use to simplify further our coding. So having the knowledge of the header file and the knowledge of C, we can use to further simplify our code. But remember, now slowly and slowly we are gradually moving towards an higher end, or we are coming to an abstract end where we are getting less information about the register, their addresses and all those stuff, but still we are still very close to the address itself. So tomorrow, if you are going to modify any program or write something new, remember this will be the base to look into a header file. Okay. So any doubt from this particular explanation? And we will see how this particular approach is going to simplify our coding. So any doubt from this part? Why we are using array? What are arrays? What are indexes of array? What are the data types an array can have? How the memory is allocated to an array? What are the initial addresses of different indexes? And how can we change a value in an index? Okay, if you don't have any doubt, you can move further. Okay, here you can see all the memories are arranged in a sequential manner. 400, 404, 408, 400C, 410, okay, and so on. So you can see here 400, 404, so 048C. 048C and so on. So again, the question can come to the mind. You can see 048C. If you write it in hexadecimal, or if you try to write the same thing in binary form, 048C. Okay. So in hexadecimal, it will be 0000. 4 means 0. 100, 8 will be 1000, C will be 12, so 84, okay, 00. Now in this case, one thing that is again coming back to my mind is that why again this, you can see this part again, that these two bits are always kept zero. Why these addresses are always 00? Okay, so please try to find the answer. It is one of the most important features of ARM architecture or any good microcontrollers architecture. Okay, so from the header file, we can make note of the important registers which we need, like data register, direction register, and slowly you can come to the port of digital enable register, and then you can write the code, or you can simply use the concept of array, and you can point to the index of that array, and you can enter any value that you like. Okay, so let us see why we are writing this code in this fashion. So above code is an example of array indexing. Okay. So let us first start with the first code. Now, you can check, further check what is the technique called and why they are using it like that. Okay. Till the last class, we found that these were the approaches by which we can define, rather than going for 1U, 2U, and that means second location, third location. So this is bit location. You can say like this, this is the bit location or first bit location D1. Okay, then you have D2. Okay, bit location, and then you have this D3 or D3 bit location. Now the question is, this is representing red LED bit location D1. You can cross check from here. Okay, D1 is P1. Okay, here. Okay, D1 is connected here. D2 is connected at P2 and D3 is connected to P3. These are all bits. Okay, not the port. Port F is this is particularly this whole is the part is port F. 8 bits of port F. Okay. Now we saw this technique, and then now, rather than using shifting or left shifting or right shifting, we will be calling it LED red, LED blue, LED green. Now, this particular register, RCGC GPIO, okay, is used to enable the clock gating. So, first step for any microcontroller is to enable the clocks at that port, because we need to first systematically give the clocks, otherwise the ports will be off. Okay, so we give the system clock. So if you go control C, so these are all the system clocks register for different peripherals. So you can come down and RCC GC1, RCGC1, GC2, GC3, and you can come for down and you can see the RCCs for your GPIO ports. Okay, a second. GPIO, if I have limits to take it. Okay, so here you have the RCC GPIOR register. This is used to provide the clock for your port F. Okay, how can you cross check? You can see it is FE608. 608 was the offset for RCGC GPIO. So to provide the clock at the fifth pin, because port F is enabled by the fifth bit of this particular register, so we entered fifth bit by left shifting towards the left shifting 1 by 5 times. So we enabled the clock for the port F. Then we used DIR register, and let me repeat again, you read this code like this: the variable is equal to variable or whatever the value is. Okay, so we are making all the LEDs blue, green, and red, okay, as an output pin. So direction register is done. Then we have the digital enable register. Again, we are making them all digitally enabled. Okay. Now, this is what the change is. GPIO port F here GPIO port F, data bits underscore R, LED blue. Now this is an array which is pointing to the third bit, that means the blue bit, or the LED which is connected to the blue LED, pin which is connected to the blue LED. So at the port F, take the indexing for the pin where the blue LED is connected, and in that enter this particular value of making the LED blue on, which is left shifting by 2 times. So this will make the LED, this will make the LED blue on. So in this way, we are using embedded C, and with the knowledge of your header file, you can make the LED on or off. And similarly, we are using the approach in which we are using the same port F data bits and entering the value for making the LED red high. Then we are taking int volatile counter 2. Why we are taking 2 counters? Again, this is an array. Okay. Int volatile. Why we are using volatile? Just a second. Shakul Mittal, why we are using volatile here? Shakul Mittal. So he is not here. Good. Okay. So Umang Gupta. Umang Gupta.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Why we are using volatile? Why we are using volatile here in this code? Any answer? No. Okay. Now, Rakshita Mundra, why we are using volatile?
Sir, because sometimes from the external sources, its value can get changed. That's why to prevent that changes.
Really? So here you want to say that volatile counter, the variable counter's value may change due to external interference. That's why we are calling it volatile. Any other answer? Because here you can see counter is not connected to any GPIO. This variable is not representing any GPIO. So there is no possibility that external, that means switches or any voltage will change the value of counter. So it is not the correct answer. Then why so we are using? Wait a second. Don't. Wait a second.
Okay.
So, Jayam Srivastava.
Yes, sir. To prevent from compiler optimization. Sir.
Yeah. So to avoid the optimization from the compiler side. Mute the microphone. Shakul, mute the microphone. Okay. Now you can see from here in the compiler, we can go to C++ compiler, and there is an option for optimization. By default, the optimization may be medium or high, or you can keep them medium or high. If the compiler optimizes this variable, then because this variable, even though this variable is written here, or this particular loop is written here, this loop does not have any significant effect on the registers or any other particular functionality of the GPIOs or timers or any other thing. So definitely the compiler will try to optimize this part to reduce to improve the speed of the program. Okay. Or to even sometimes save some extra memory. To avoid that part, we are using volatile. Now we are using counter variable with a type of array with 2 indexes, or we can say 2 different values are there. Now, in counter zero, we are defining the counter zero is less than or less than equal to less than 10 lakh. So 1 million or 10 lakh, and counter this particular thing. Now what is this doing here? Counter plus one, and then asterisk outside that particular thing. What is this doing? We had defined an array counter with two indexes. Index zero. This one is in the index zero, and then this index one. So two values are there inside that. What is this doing? Counter plus one, and then asterisk outside the bracket.
Checking the second index of the counter variable.
Yeah, this is again using the pointer to dereference the counter array. Remember, I showed you the array. Even in that array, we can use pointers to point to a particular location. So counter zero, okay, is this one, and counter plus one will be this one. So, and then we want to change the value in that memory location. So in that memory location, which is allocated to counter this one, okay, so counter one is this one, to change the value in that particular counter, we are using dereferencing of that particular counter plus one pointer. Okay, so now what will happen, we can use two different variables rather than, because in the previous program we had a limitation that the LED will be on and off for equal time period, but now using the array and pointer, we can have the LED which is getting on for a certain time period and off for a different time period. Okay, so in this way we can further simplify the program, or we can have more flexibility in the program by using array and pointers. Okay, so please make note of this program, and you can use it in your hardware to see how the system is working. Yeah, I have zoomed out, don't worry. So initially this is what you have done, including the header file, defining the LEDs by using left shift. Okay, so LED red is shifting the one by one times, LED blue is shifting the one two times. Wait a second, what does that mean? Shifting one times, you can see you will reach at P1 here. Okay, sorry, you will reach here at the P1. Shifting one two times, you will reach here. Shifting one three times, you will reach here. Okay, then with the help of a header file, we can find the clock for the GPIOs, and in that we are entering left shifting the one by five times. Why five times? Because GPIO F, okay, port F is the fifth bit of RCGC GPIO. Okay, then we can use direction register from the header file, data digital enable register from the header file, and then we use the concept of array. Okay, array indexing to make an LED high. The same concept we have used in the while loop to make the red LED high. Okay, then we have used two different values in an array with a variable called counter. It is volatile because the compiler should not optimize this particular variable. Otherwise, while doing optimization, it will delete all the functionalities of this particular counter variable. And in the counter zero, which is index zero, we are comparing with this particular value. Okay, and then incrementing the count. Then when the count reaches to 10 lakh or 1 million, it will come out of this loop. Then after that, we are making the LED red low. Now we are using the the second counter variable which is here and dereferencing that value using pointer. Then again incrementing the counter one, and once the counter one reaches to this value, it will be out of that loop, and this loop will keep on running because we are inside while loop. Okay, while one. So this is what the program is going to do. So unfortunately we are not in the classroom, otherwise I would have shown you the working of this particular program. Okay, now let me check the second example, what was different in that. I don't think any.
Sir, whenever we need two counters in a code, is it good to use a counter as a two counters as separate variables or like an array?
Depends on you. Preferably go for two rather than going for two different variables, keep an array. Because, okay, until unless you want two different variables with two different data types. Okay, if int is solving your so-called, for example, what I mean by that? Because array will always use the same data type. Until unless the same array, so-called, wait a second, close this. Until unless you want two different data types, here both counter 1 and counter 2 will be int, integer type. If you don't want them to be of same type, preferably go for two different data types. But if they can do your job by keeping the same data type, then go for it, no issues. For example, you cannot have, you cannot get a value like this in a char. So you cannot use char here. Okay, so it will not be serving your purpose of long delays. So you can choose accordingly. Until unless you need two different data types, prefer array. Okay. Okay, let me check this part. Let me run this code and wait a second, stopping. Okay. So here, what we are doing, the same first part is same using three different LEDs and using the same left shift by one, left shift by two, left shift by three. Okay, now we are waiting in the int main and we are going to use a variable y which will have three components, one, two, three. Okay, so let us see. So right now the variable y is not declared, so it is unavailable. Pointer p is not declared, so it is unavailable right now. Let us check. So now variable y is an array. If you click here in the positive sign, you can see there are three components in y, 0, 1, 2. Are there the indexes? Variable 0, 1, 2. Okay. So in that variable, we have in the first index, you can see you have 1. In the second index, it is having 2. And in the third index, you have 3. So you can enter three different values. Now, the thing you have to keep in mind is you see here the variables are provided three different memory locations also here. Okay. 2000FF0, 2000FF4, 2000FF8. Again, you can see 048. If you give a fourth variable, or if you have the fourth component also, like Y4, and if you introduce 4, it will be again 8. Then after that, you will get C, which is 12. So 048, 12. the ARM will keep on incrementing in that same fashion, 048 till 04812. Okay, now LED red means shifting by one, and we are going to try to enter 5U in that memory location. So you can see the red, okay, is there, but the value is entered in the second LED position. Why in the second LED position? Because here you see we have executed this part, Y LED red equal to 5U, and the value is entered in the second index of the array. 5, okay, is entered into the second index of the array. And let me go for the second also. So Y LED red equal to LED red. Now even in that case you can see there is no change, so everything is same. Now the question is why 5 is coming into the second index here? Anyone? Why the 5, this value 5, is entered to the second index, whereas we have told that LED red is shifting by one position? Then why it came here 5? Or is the code correct or not? First thing, is the code correct or not? Hello, anyone? Is the code correct or not? Why we are getting into the second index of the variable? That is, in the beginning it is defined LED red equal to 1U. Oh, you got the answer anyway. See here, the thing is, though you are shifting it one time, actually there is two move shifting taking place. So one and then two. Okay, one for P0 by default, and then you have shifted it one time, though you have written it one time, but the bit has been shifted to the second place. So that means second place. So two, okay, second place. Now if you come here and see the second place of Y3 is, this is the 0th place, 1st place and the 2nd place. Understood? So this kind of things may actually make you confused. But remember, here 1U means move to the 2nd place. Okay, you can read it like that also. So shifting by 1 means moving to the 2nd place. So 2nd place here is 0, 1. And second place is this one. So go to the second place of Y and enter 5 in that. So here you have 5. So if you tomorrow, you might be thinking, I'm going to make an LED high or low, or this port's bit will be high or low. And if it is not working, then do remember this thing. Writing or shifting a bit by 1, okay, this means going to the second place of the registers. Here it means going to the third place, going to the fourth place. Okay, and here the indexing starts from 0, 1, 2. Okay, so go to the second place of the variable and enter the value. Clear? And now we have the pointer P declared. So pointer P is declared right now, not initialized. Okay, and P, now we are telling that this pointer is attached to the address of Y1. What is the address of Y1? Address of Y1 is this one, 2000FF4. So before you just declared a pointer, now that pointer is attached to an address. Okay, and now this part is called dereferencing the pointer. So that means now from here onwards you can use star P and then assign a particular value to that address. So whatever be the value in that address, you can change it by dereferencing by using star P. Now let us check here. So now P, you can see here, P is pointing, your pointer is pointing towards this address, FF4. Okay, because you have entered 1 here. So the index of 1, address for the index of 1 is pointed by this pointer. Now the pointer is attached. Now after that, you can write asterisk P. This is called dereferencing. Okay, so dereferencing, this is referencing in that, indirectly you can call it referencing or attaching a pointer to an address and then dereferencing. So now you can use star P and write over whatever value you want, and that value will be entered to the location which is pointed by the pointer. So this is the location which is pointed, and after this 10 U will be entered into that particular location. Clear? Please keep, make note of these things, because these are the most, some of the most complex things or most confusing things for the students most of the time. Okay, now if suppose I ask you to take the same code and modify the code, all the that part of the code, to access the advanced high speed bus. That means the port, before we were using the address for 4002-5000, which is basically the address of APB, 4002-5000. This was the address for APB. So if suppose someone asks you, take all this feature and shift the bus, the internal bus, to AHP, then in that case everything will remain same. Only thing you have to do is go to the header file and check what is that register which is allowing us to enable AHP. Okay, so we know that there are two internal buses, advanced peripheral bus and advanced high speed bus. To switch from APB to AHB, okay, you have to just check the address, offset address of HB, okay, advanced, sorry, GPIO, high performance bus. So now the offset is 06C, that's all. Okay, so the base address of the GPIO plus an offset will take you to that particular location. One approach is that, or otherwise you can use GPIO HBCTL to search inside the header file. Okay, so port F is here, fifth bit, which is same for the APB also, fifth bit, and then you can use the HB by going to that particular address. Okay, so the system clock, sorry, the system clock for the advanced high speed bus is this one, GPIO HB high speed bus. Okay, control underscore register. Again, you are going to the fifth bit location because you want to make the GPIO port F's clock on. So making the clock on, and then after that you just know the addresses of the GPIO port I showed you, and you can directly change the program from APB to AHB. Everything is same. Here we are enabling the clock for AHB, fifth bit, okay, and then GPIO port F, AHB DIR. Now if you go to the data sheet, GPIO underscore F, can't find, wait a second, port F, okay. Okay, so here you have the port F registers. Come down. Sorry, this is normal APB bus 4000 to 5000. HB will be different. Wait a second. So this is the port F with AHB, advanced high speed bus. Now this is the base address 4005D000, and same rest of the registers are all same, that is with the APB also. Port F has got all the same registers. So again you will have to take the help of data register, direction register and digital enable register. Clear? So in the code, if you see, you are going to make a very small change. Okay, let me keep these two codes side by side. Okay, so here you are using port F AHB DIR underscore R, whereas in this part you are using just GPIO port F data bits, sorry, AHB. Wait a second. This one DIR register. So what is the change here? Only thing is you have introduced AHB in the code. So you can just briefly go to the header file, check where the addresses or what are the variables for AHB for port F, and use that particular variable in place of GPIO port F DIR. Okay, so DIR is there, then you have DEN, then you have data, AHB, data bits. Similar, everything is same, only thing is you have introduced this particular part, AHB. Okay, so that will just shift your bus internally from advanced peripheral bus to advanced high speed bus. Any doubt till this part? Tomorrow in maybe possible you will have to develop your own codes for different ports or different GPIOs. So in that time or in that case, I might not be helping you to search in the header files or anything. So till now, whatever I have taught, if you have doubts, you can ask. I told you how to check the data sheets, how to understand the header files, how to write code using embedded C. If you have any doubts, you can ask now. Otherwise, we can proceed to the next topic.
So when to use AHB exactly?
When you need very high speed performance, because AHB will provide you perfect 80 megahertz speed, full 80 megahertz speed.
So some examples.
Wherever you need very high speed applications for communication, especially whenever you want to go for high speed communication, okay, or whenever you need very high speed triggering kind of stuff, then in that case you can use advanced peripheral bus, high speed bus, sorry. Okay, because it can run up to 80 megahertz. That's the only difference which it makes. In the beginning, I told you, if you wait a second. And if you ask what are the high speed applications, I in my opinion, wherever you need very high speed performance, like communication especially, or controlling some motors at a very high speed, you can go for that, where you need to trigger very fast responses. Bus, let me check, not the bus here. So architectural overview. Let me check here. Yeah, here. So you have these two buses. Okay, advanced high performance bus and high advanced peripheral bus. Okay, high performance means high speed bus. Okay, and I told you that all the peripherals are not connected to advanced high speed bus. For example, here you can see watchdog timer is only connected with APB. So definitely you will not get the details regarding watchdog timer connecting to AHB. AHB it is not connected, so you cannot use that feature. When the system is in hibernation module is activated, in that case also you cannot use AHB because it is not connected. Timers are not connected to AHB. Okay, so what are the components which are connected to AHB? Of course, DMA is connected to both AHB and APB. EEPROM is definitely need very high speed performance in that bus, so therefore you are having the access to AHB. GPIOs similar to that of DMA, you can access both AHB and APB. Okay, USB, of course, like I said, for communication you need very high speed data transfer, so you can access AHB. Other than that, there is no peripheral which allows you to access AHB. So USB, GPIO, EEPROM, DMA, these four peripherals can access AHB, rest no. And you can simply think from your mind also that hibernation module, why you need very high speed 80 megahertz bus for hibernation when it is sleeping? Timers, they have their own timing speed and clock. Why do you need very high speed bus for that? When they can UART serial communication, serial communication, you don't need a very high speed bus for that. Okay, so, and definitely this is the architecture of this particular microcontroller. It may be possible that different microcontrollers may give the facility to access AHB from different peripherals also. So depends from architecture to architecture. I'm not constraining that I2C is not important, therefore I2C cannot access a high performance bus. Maybe for different architecture they may have different facilities. CAN control network, if you are developing, might be possible another microcontroller will give you AHB bus. Okay. Other than that, there are some registers like temporary registers, R0 to R12 is there. Then we studied that there are other registers like program status register, program counter, stack pointer, and all those registers are there. Let us look at them one by one. Program status register, okay, PSR, actually handles three different registers, we can say. One is application program status register, execution program status register, interrupt program status register. In all case it is status. Status registers are mostly used when we want to know the current status of our program. So basically we use to read them. Okay, so what are the in other words, can you correlate this with 8085? Which
flag? Was
flag. So only flag. So that means we can read them. We cannot go and write on them directly. So here application related status will be provided by APSR. Bit number 31 to 27 and bit number 19 to 16. Are all dedicated for APSR. Bit number 26 to 24 and 15 to 10 are dedicated for execution related status. And interrupt related status can be checked by using IPSR, okay, which are bit number 0 to 7. Let us briefly see how these things are arranged. So this is your program status register. In that, the first NZCVQ and the 19 to 16 GE register. So this part are all belonging to the first part, which is application program status register. Then you have 26 to 24 and 10 to 15 dedicated for execution related status information. And the last here, bit number 0 to 7 will give you the information relating to the status of interrupt. Okay, so there are all three different types: RW, RO, and what does that mean? RW, read and write, both are allowed. RO, read only, read write, and read write. Okay, so using these particular bits, we can check the status of particular application. Okay, so program status register has three functions. Like we decoded from the data sheet: application program status, we can execution program status, and interrupt program status. So these three things we can know from the status of these registers. How we can know that? Focus on 31 to 27. If you want to take the data out, and then you can do anding or oring. That means masking. By using the masking approach, we can know whether the bit is 0 or 1. By knowing whether the bit is 0 or 1, we can tell what is happening inside that particular register. PSR, IPSR, EPSR, that means these three registers can be accessed only in privileged mode. We will come later to the modes. Okay, there are basically two modes, privileged and unprivileged. Unprivileged means mostly for the users. This mode is for the users. So user can come and change the values or contents and so on. Privileged means basically for system only. Okay, so in here, of course, system can access them. System can also change them. System and users both can go or use the things which are allowed in the unprivileged mode. In the privileged mode, users cannot go directly and change the system's configuration. Only thing is the system user cannot go and change the values in unprivileged mode. Privileged mode is for the system only. So APSR register, like they say, can be used by user or the system both. Okay, whereas PSR, IPSR, EPSR, these are only accessible in privileged mode. Okay, by the system. Okay, there are hacks, but still remember, privileged means mostly accessible only by the system. Unprivileged user can use them. Okay, we saw the APSR, that what are the parts of APSR. Okay, so APSR contains following ALU status flag. Arithmetic logical units status flags are there, like N, Z, C, and V, and these are all almost similar to that of your 8085. So N representing negative number, or operation was negative, and Z representing that after the operation the result is zero, after the operation there was a carry generated, and after the operation there was an overflow generated. So I have discussed these two in 8051. What is the difference between carry and overflow? What is the difference between carry and overflow? Carry will occur whenever the after the, for example, like this one. So if you add these two, they will generate a carry one. Okay, carry one will be generated, so this will be zero, and a carry will be generated, CY. So this is your content of accumulator, and carry is generated. Then what is overflow?
6th bit to 7th bit.
Right now we have only 4 bits. This is a 4-bit system. What is overflow?
Third to fourth bit, transfer of one from third to fourth bit.
Sir, there are two conditions for overflow when there is
Wait a second. Let me first clear his doubt. So suppose I have a system which is 8-bit system, and we are going to add these two numbers using that in that 8-bit system. You will get 0, 0, 0, and 1 plus 1 you will get 0, and this here you have taken a carry. So here you will get 1 and then 0, 0, and then 1 plus 1 will generate a carry, so it will be 0, and here you have a carry flag. So now you are saying that when there is a overflow from D3 to D4, okay, this is D0, 1, 2, 3. So D3 to D4, you are saying it is overflow.
Sorry, sir, it is auxiliary carry.
So this is different. This is auxiliary carry. Okay, not overflow. Okay, continue the other student who was saying about the overflow.
Sir, for example, here we have 8-bit numbers. So in two conditions overflow can occur. One is from when there is one being carried from bit D6 to D7 and there is no carry from bit D7, or there is no carry from bit D6 to D7 and there is a carry from bit D7.
Yeah, so there is a difference between these two. That means overflow will be considered when there is an overflow from this to this. That means if there was one and one here. But remember, in that case, there should not be any overflow from this particular location, D7 to D8. Okay. And otherwise, vice versa is also possible. So remember, overflow and carry are almost same when there is one overflow from the D7 to D8. But D6 to D7 can also take place, provided there should not be any carry from D7th bit. Okay. Now, here we are using 32-bit system, therefore overflow will take place when there is a 1 generated from the D31, okay, D31 to D32. Okay, remember there is D0 also, so D0 to D31 is your 32-bit system, okay, 32-bit. And when there is an overflow, that means D31 to D32, okay. Then in that case, we will call it carry. Overflow D30 to D31 can also take place, provided D32 should not be generated. Okay, generating a carry in that case. Okay. Now, stack pointer. You can recall what is the use of stack pointer, why it is used, and so on. Okay. Stack pointer here is represented by register R13. R0 to R12 is your regular normal registers. R13 is your stack pointer. Okay. Okay, there is one more thread mode. Okay, in that, depending on the ASP bit, there is ASP bit in the control register, we can generate or we can look into the stack pointer. So there is a control register. Okay, in that you have the ASP bit, and ASP bit is active stack pointer's location. Okay, so if it is 1, PSP is current stack pointer. Okay, and if it is 0, MSP is the current stack pointer. Don't worry, we are not going into that depth, but stack, you remember that stack is used to locate, when is stack used basically?
To store the return address.
Yeah, whenever you are taking a jump or whenever there is a branch instruction, when the microprocessor changes its routine job of point program counter. So here you have written a program. So user program is there. just briefly I'm telling you because we have covered this in 8085. So suppose address is XXXX.YYYY. So in this address, you started writing your program and the program ended in an address AAAA.BBBB. So assume in between that, there is a command which is related to loop, like while, jump, if else or something like that. Okay. In that case, what the program counter will do is program, even sometimes when you are using interrupts, when the microprocessor has to stop its current execution or current instructions execution and jumps to a location which is pointed by the interrupt service routine. Okay. So in all such cases, the program counter, where it was behaving like PC plus one, whenever the program counter moves away from this so-called function and it takes a jump to some other location, that means from here, it has to go to some other location, then in that case, the microcontroller first what it does is, he will note the next location after the program counter and take this to the stack. Okay, so stack will be pointing to a memory location where the next location of the program counter will be stored, so that after executing the ISR, assume ISR, after executing the ISR, when there is a return passed by the microcontroller, return does not tell the address where to return, only return will be passed. Then whenever the microcontroller receives a return, it goes and checks the stack. What is the content of the stack? Current content of the stack rather. So from there, he will retrieve the address and it will go back to the location where it was executing the main program. Okay. So in this way, stack pointers are used. Okay. Link register. Link register is almost like the stack register, but here link register is R14. It stores the return information for subroutines, function calls, and exceptions. Okay. So link register is almost like the stack pointer, but it stores the information for the returning address from for subroutines, function calls, and exceptions. So stack pointer we know from 8085 and 8051, but link register is one more addition into that particular behavior. But remember, link register is for subroutines, function calls, and exceptions. Exceptions, mostly we can say, mostly they are errors or exceptions means system, in when the system is not running in a normal way or it is changing its behavior suddenly. Okay, so in such cases, exceptions can take place, mostly errors. Okay, so link register can be accessed by both in privileged or unprivileged mode, so user can access them. Okay. Okay, we are not going in depth of the link register, but still in the data sheet you can check. So link register is R14. It stores the return information for these three things which we had discussed. Okay, so these are all the details you can extract from the header file. Okay, remember link register is again 32-bit because you can point to an address between 0000 to FFFF. Okay. Now program counter. We know that the program counter actually points to the location where the current instruction is being executed. So here register R15 is your program counter. Okay. And remember, whenever we press the reset in the microcontroller board, the program counter returns to 0000 or the 0000 address. But here one interesting fact is there that when we press the reset button, the program counter returns to 0000004. Please go through the data sheet and check it is true or false. Okay. And secondly, you can check it from the simulator also. Whenever you reset in between the program execution, for example, let me check if I have the program. No, no program is running. Let me go back. Okay. Okay. Okay, you can see now we are going to execute the program. So right now the program is somewhere here at 05000005C. Okay, and I go back and reset the program. Okay, now you can see the program has returned to the memory location 0000040. The reset is not taking you back to the initial address 0000000. Rather, it is taking you to 40 address. So, yes, it is true, but okay, it is 40. Okay. So now the question is, you have to check why it is going back to 40 rather than going to 0000. Why it is not going to the initial basic initial address. So this is again one more task added to your previous tasks. Okay, it can be used either in privileged and unprivileged mode. Okay, now we are coming to the next feature again, where we can use two different features. One is from the data sheet and the header file. Along with that, we can use the features of C to further improve the coding skill or the program or make it more efficient. Stack in help C helps to understand interrupts and context switch. So we know that interrupts, whenever interrupts are generated, stack is helpful to understand those stuffs. We will check that in the program. Okay. Now, functions allow a programmer to avoid repetition of the same code. Whenever we are repeating the same code again and again, we can use function instead of the program to repeat. Okay. So functions actually allow you to avoid repetition of the code. So suppose there you have to repeat a particular code 1000 times. Don't do that. Make a function. And that function will be used to repeat the whole bunch of codes, which otherwise will increase the length of the program. So functions are very important. So remember, we should use functions when we don't have to repeat any particular part of the program. Okay. Functions are also known as subroutines, procedures, and subprograms in other languages. So whenever you come across these words, subroutine, when we were using assembly, we were mostly using this part. So assembly code gave birth to, we can say, assembly code's subroutine term can be coined here as a function. Okay. Similarly, in other languages, there may be some people might be calling it procedures. You can again recall or correlate the same procedures with functions in C. So what are the minimum requirements of a function? Every function should have its own name, every function should have some arguments, we will come to that, and the function should provide some return type, mostly data type. You can think of returning type means what kind of data the function is returning. So these three things combined together makes a function. Let us explore more. First line of the function defines, tells the compiler in order from, okay. Remember, functions are read from left to right. Okay. First, who can call that function? This is the information that we can extract from the compiler can extract. Who can call? That means, can another function call this function, or main can call this function? Of course, main is also a function. What type of returns or what type of values are returned by that function, the name of that function and argument it takes. Let us check an example code. It will be more easier to understand from the example itself. It is taking so much time. Too many things running. Like this. You have the name of the function, which is main. Type of the function is float. Return type, you can call it. And void here is the argument. Okay, and in that function you are just typing, printing that programming is fun, that's all. And return 0.00, why .00? Because it is the return type is float rather than int. So three things you have to keep in mind: the name of the function is main, data type or the return type of the function is float, and void is the argument inside the function. And inside the function, you are just printing one particular term called programming is fun. So this is the function, how you define it. Okay. Let me check last. After this, we will be ending the lecture. And then we will introduce the concepts of function in our program. And we will take help of that. For example, here the main is the function name, integer is the return type of the function, and void is the argument. So remember, even though this part is written before the main, when the C programming is compiler is used, starts compilation, it starts from the main, and inside that you have declared a variable I whose data type is integer, and here you have the loop for I is equal to 1 to less than equal to 5 plus I. So it will keep on incrementing until unless I reaches to 5. Okay, and it will print a message which is blank right now, print message, and this is the return type. But now the question is, print message is a function, because this symbol tells that you are using a function, print message. So print message. So when this particular line is running, suddenly the program switches from the program counter switches from this location to suddenly this particular location where the function is there. Now you are calling a different function. The name of the function is print message. The data type is, or return type is void, and argument is also void. And you are just printing one particular thing. So that means this program will keep on repeating 5 times. So you will get the answer, or you will get this particular line printed 5 times. Programming is fun. Programming is fun. Programming is fun. Programming is fun. Otherwise, what you can do, you can write programming is fun 5 times in the function. Okay. So remember, whenever you have to repeat something, because here you can see there is a repeated task, avoid repeating the things, use functions instead. That will reduce the load on the code as well as it will reduce the size of the code and make the code more efficient. So by this, we are ending the lecture here. Next class, we will see how the embedded C and function can be used in our codes. Okay.